Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters, wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'd like to welcome you all to our final session on Surah Tawbah. I think we did about 30 sessions. This will be the final one, and inshallah, in today's session, we'll be covering verses 123 to 129. So we left off at verse 123, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قَاتِلُوا الَّذِينَ يَلُونَكُمْ مِنَ الْكُفَّارِ وَلْيَجِدُوا فِيكُمْ غِلْظَةً وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Allah says, O you who believe, fight those disbelievers who are near to you and let them find in you firmness and know that God is with the pious. Now, these verses come right after the discussion on the Battle of Tabuk. If you recall, the Battle of Tabuk was a unique military expedition because it required the Prophet and his companions to travel a very long distance near the Roman border. Now, upon returning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shares with the Prophet and with the believers an important tactical strategy when it comes to conquest, when it comes to expanding the Muslim lands. And that is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is essentially saying that you have to first strengthen your base. You have to strengthen your own borders. You have to strengthen yourself within, and you have to do that before you expand. So before you go out, you go further out, the borders have to be secured. The Muslim community has to be strengthened. Now, when Allah says, O you who believe, fight the disbelievers who are near to you. Now, of course, this is not a general verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not commanding the Prophet and the Muslims to be hostile against non-Muslims or disbelievers. But here, the kuffar in this specific context is a reference to those disbelievers who are living at the borders of the Islamic State and who are antagonizing the Muslims, who are fighting the Muslims, who are invading the Muslim lands. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling the believers that before thinking about remote enemies, before confronting remote and distant enemies, you have to be aware and you have to confront the enemies that are lurking, at your borders. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu qatilu alladhina yalunakum min al-kuffar." That this is almost a strategy for gradual conquest, that you have to address the immediate dangers, because some of the Muslims, perhaps when they went to the Roman, the border of Rome, they probably started to think about the prospects of expanding. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds them that before you become too ambitious, you have to address the immediate dangers. So number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who believe, fight the disbelievers who are near you. Now the disbelievers here are not any disbelievers. We're talking about a very specific group of disbelievers. These are, combatant disbelievers. These are hostile enemies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, fight those who are near you. Don't be too fixated on distant enemies. Address the immediate dangers. قَاتِلُوا الَّذِينَ يَلُونَكُمْ مِنَ الْكُفَّارِ وَلْيَجِدُوا فِيكُمْ غِلْظَةً. And Allah says, so, O you who believe, fight those who disbelieve, who are near to you, meaning fight the hostile combatant disbelievers who are near to you, and let them find in you firmness. Now the word غِلْظَة, I was looking at some of the translations of the word غِلْظَة, and unfortunately, some translators, they mistranslate this word and they say, and let them find in you harshness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never instructs believers to be harsh with anyone. But rather, ghilza here, a more accurate translation is to be firm, meaning that do not be passive, that you have to. There are times where leniency should be the policy, but there are other times when the believers have to be firm, that especially when we're talking about securing the borders and protecting the Muslim community from invaders and from hostile enemies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, because this is a religion that's always promoting peace and mercy and gentleness and compassion, you find that Allah makes it a point to say that when you're dealing with these types of enemies, do not be lenient. Do not be compassionate with them. You have to be firm, because we're talking about an issue of safety. وَلْيَجِدُوا فِيكُمْ غِلْظَةً وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. And know that God is with the pious. Now, interestingly, after the death of the Prophet, we know that especially during the time of the second Khalifa, there was the Muslim lands were expanding. The Muslims were conquering new lands. Even after the death of the Prophet, this verse was used to guide the conquests that were taking place. Now, even during the time of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, you know, when the Islamic empire was continually expanding, you know, people would ask the Imam alayhi salam about, you know, the practical application of this verse. So they would come to the Imam and say that, you know, should Muslims expand into further into Sham, or should they expand into the Persian Empire? So, you know, after the death of the Prophet, the Muslims had to make a decision. So, you know, do we expand into the territory of Sham first, or do we expand into the Persian Empire? And you find that the Imam alayhi salam, he mentions this verse, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu qatilu alladhina yalunakum min al-kuffar. Fight against the disbelievers who are close to you. So the Imam alayhi salam, he would say that go to Daylam, which was another name for the Persian Empire. So you have the Persian Empire and you have the Roman Empire, and the Muslims choose to expand into the Persian Empire because it's closer, because it's that low-hanging fruit. So this verse was even used, you know, as a way to guide the expansions that took place after the death of the Prophet. Now, we can also look at this verse not only through the lens of military conquest and dealing with hostile enemies. So instead of only looking at this verse from the context and through the lens of military strategy, which is what is being directly referenced in this verse, we can also look at this verse as a verse that guides us on how to propagate Islam. You know, we as communities, you know, sometimes we focus so much on bringing people into Islam that we forget to strengthen our own community. You know, we speak so much about interfaith dialogue, right, that we forget to address some of the more immediate challenges, which is intra-faith dialogue. You know, even if you look at the way that the Prophet propagated Islam, he always confronted the immediate challenges. The Prophet was a master at prioritizing. And that's what this verse is really about. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling the Muslims that, yes, you have many enemies. You have distant enemies and you have enemies who are close to you. You have to prioritize. You have to confront the immediate dangers. You have to deal with the immediate enemies before you expand further. So if you look at the Prophet in Mecca, when the Prophet began disseminating his message, he started with who? He approached his family members, those who are closest to him. And then after propagating the message for 3 years in secret, Allah says to the Prophet, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, and warn your nearest of kin. So even the message of Islam was propagated in a way where the Prophet is kind of conquering the hearts that are closest to him. And then he expands and he reaches out to those who are outside of his immediate circle. So it's important for us to really look at this verse from a strategic perspective, that even when it comes to building our own communities, we have to identify the immediate dangers, the immediate challenges, address those first before we use our resources to take on some of the more ambitious projects. Now, the verse ends with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الْمُتَّقِينَ, that God is with the pious. Now, the verse is speaking essentially about military combat, speaking about fighting. And usually when there is military conflict, when two armies clash, the last thing that people think about is what? God consciousness, upholding morality and ethics. But you find that, especially in the context of war, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds the believers of this notion of taqwa. You know, that taqwa is not just about, you know, eating halal food and avoiding haram food. Taqwa is not just about, you know, praying on time. It's not just about, you know, fulfilling, you know, religious rituals. That taqwa has to be observed even in the battlefield. You have to be God conscious. You cannot oppress your enemies. That even if you're dealing with the most barbaric people, you should never become barbaric like them, because you have to maintain that taqwa. And a contemporary example of this is in the instructions that Sayyid Sistani gave to those who were fighting against Daesh, who were fighting against ISIS. That if you look at the advice that Sayyid Sistani was giving to those who are fighting ISIS, throughout that letter, there are constant reminders of the sanctity of human life, that to not transgress the limits, understanding that, you know, you have to be cautious when it comes, even to, you know, even when it comes to fighting against, you know, people like that. So وَعْلَمُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الْمُتَّقِينَ, that we always have to remind ourselves, we have to be God conscious when we're dealing with enemies. In the Quran, when Allah speaks about divorce, you know, Allah always mentions taqwa at times where emotions are running high. When you're fighting against, you know, hostile enemies, it's natural for your emotions to get the best of you and to kind of, you know, cross red lines. But Allah says you have to be people of taqwa. You have to be people of consciousness. When it comes to divorce, again, it's a very emotional time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah At-Talaq, He's always reminding us to be conscious of Him, to have taqwa, to be people of morality.
Could you explain what was the moral framework that legitimizes the expansion during the time of the Khalifas? Because I know it was considered a normal thing back then, but today, if you're using military expansion, that's looked at in a normal, of a different lens nowadays.
So it's important for us to note that these military expansions were not happening under the authority of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. Now, you know, when your question is about what's the moral
Right. How do you say that the expansions are okay? Like, well, how do you justify the expansions?
You know, I think that when you look at the expansions that took place after the death of the Prophet, a lot of them were problematic. You know, that's why, you know, when we say, you know, we're familiar with the slogan that, you know, Islam was spread by the sword. it's accurate to say that the Islamic empire was spread by the sword. You know, if you look at what many of the Khulafa did after the Prophet, yeah, I think that there is truth to that. You know, whether we want to admit it or not, if you look at the facts, that there were a lot of un-Islamic things that happened after the death of the Prophet. Now, Islam as an ideology, yeah, Islam as an ideology spread because of the character of the Prophet, because of the beauty of its teachings, but territory was expanded by and large through military force. And we believe as followers of Ahlul Bayt that type of expansion is only sanctioned under the guidance of the majority of Shia fuqaha. They believe that type of expansion is only sanctioned under the authority of the Ma'soom. And some scholars, like Sayyid al-Khuy, they say under the authority of a marja, where, you know, people just can't decide to invade and conquer lands. It doesn't work like that. So even the Khulafa that came after, from the perspective of the followers of Ahlul Bayt, they had no authority to even be in that position, let alone use military force to expand the Islamic empire.
Okay, and so presumably it would only be done when there is a specific justifications for it.
Exactly.
Not as a general principle.
No, not as a general principle. Absolutely.